Good evening and welcome to another meeting in the series Laboratory of the Future. This part of our project is called Together Apart. We launched it in the autumn of 2012 and it will continue until the end of April 2013. As the name has it, we are here to reflect on the future, in particular visions for future society. We've had the pleasure to have with us Christian Lupa, Magdalena Środa, and Sławomir Magala last year. This semester looks just as exciting. Tonight, we will talk about Jihad versus McWorld. Our guests tonight are Professor Janusz Danecki and Dr. Monika Bobako. The moderator, as usual in this part of our series, is Edwin Bendyk. We also have an interesting arts program tonight. Our guest, both in person and through her works, is the Turkish artist CANAN. She's an artist, feminist. Her works, which we exhibit, and others, focus on the position of woman and oppressive society, in this case, Turkish society. The other artist we are exhibiting is Adel Abdessemed. We will present his video tonight. He's an Algerian artist. He left Algeria in 1994 during the political upheaval. And as it is, he seems to encounter political upheavals all the time. So his work focuses on very problematic issues relating to politics and history. Ironically, from the perspective of the title of our project, Adel says that we do not need hope. What we need is the truth. So welcome, and let's begin with a performance by CANAN. It will be put up on screen. The artist will be visible to you. But if you want to approach the screen, there are seats still available. The performance will take 5 minutes. You can also stand up if you like. And then we will rearrange the room before we begin the discussion. And after that, at the back of the room, we have the videos put up for you and a glass of wine over which to continue our deliberations. Now let's begin with the performance. I need to apologize because of our webcast and all the media requirements. I hope we can handle the technical difficulties in our debate. So the first question, the recurring question, Professor, let me rephrase it. Were you surprised by the Arab Spring? Because most of the world seemed to be surprised. American experts and the media for many weeks failed to take note of what was going on, and they only took note when it became apparent that the regimes would not continue, that there would be a change. Only then did they start to comment and react politically. But for many weeks, everyone pretended this was yet another rebellion that would quickly be stabilized, as the term had it, that everything would go back to normal. On the Nile, quiet would prevail. Yes, everyone was surprised. Everyone was surprised by the developments in Poland in 1989. Back then, everyone thought, well, Poles were unruly and rebellious, but would quickly be crushed. And this was our thinking about the Middle East. We thought the Middle East would calm down, and it happened quite abruptly in Tunisia. This happened because of one minor situation, a death, self-immolation of Boazi, a young man, out of despair. That's why he did it. And others like him, thousands other young people who were jobless, had no future. Apologies for that. I hope that's better. So people without future, without prospects for the future, they just rebelled, and they were followed by the others, the rest of society. And we quickly understood that it was not just a transitory development, it was something much more serious, especially when the president, whose name means the ornament of those who adore God, that was his name. Well, he resigned, and society forced him to do that. Why? Because it was the wealthiest society among the non-oil-producing Arab states or republics. That's one point. And they were very European. Thousands, if not millions, of tourists came to their countries. And Tunisia was very closely related to France. Hundreds of thousands of Tunisians live in France, and so they knew what they wanted. They didn't want what they had. They wanted something new. And I have my theory why it happened across the Middle East. The theory actually is based on a reference to Poland. That's why I started talking about Poland in the beginning. If you look at what happened, there were two kinds of countries. On the one hand, republics, so-called democratic republics, people democracies, people's democracies, perhaps, but in fact not very democratic. People were forced to say that they were free, that they were being, that they were democratic, that they could do what they wanted to, that they could elect parliaments and presidents, provided that they elected the right president and that the parliament would make that choice for them. They had no say in it, just as had been the case in Poland. And for young people, actually for everyone, this made for a very uncomfortable living. They felt that they were lying to themselves. And that was unbearable, as you say in your opening essay, this sense of lies was what made the difference. On the other hand, there were kingdoms, and nothing happened there. There was no lies in kingdoms. The king was the monarch, the ruler, and those were the king's countries. This is what the Saudis say. The Saudis say, it is our country. We build it. We make it. It's ours. And the people are happy, and the same is true of Morocco or Bahrain is an exception to the rule. And then the other republic where nothing ever happened so far is Algeria. But Algeria, as we know, has just gone through a civil war, and the results of the civil war reflect upon the recent developments. In Bahrain, the kingdom of Bahrain, the ruling elite occupies its country. It has since the late 18th century. They are occupants, though. They are aliens. They speak a different language. They prefer a different religion. The newcomers are Sunnites. The locals are Shiites. And that is a kind of Shiism close to Iran, but they are Arabs. And this is why there was a change. However, republics followed, whereas the kingdoms did not. And this is what seems to be the case today. And it doesn't seem to be very surprising. It doesn't seem to be really changing in the future, but perhaps we will be surprised. Monika, are you happy with the professor's interpretation as a person who travels a lot in the Middle East and sees the culture firsthand? Well, I think something did happen in the Kingdom of Morocco. The events in Algeria did reflect upon that country. But let me go back to the moment of surprise you mentioned. That's one thing. And also the problems in understanding what really happened and what is still going on. This was very clear. First of all, these developments stirred some concern of many groups, many players on the geopolitical scene who felt worried and concerned about the attempts to topple the regimes in the Arab countries. And this concern was combined with an attempt at reinterpreting and reappropriating the revolutions. There were many different attempts. The Iranian attempt to present the revolution as an export of the Islamic revolution. Others tried to interpret that as a middle-class revolt. There were many different interpretations, but what I am really interested in and makes me think that the Arab Spring is a very special moment in time is that, well, what is key before we try to unpack the sense of this event is to think about the very issue of constructing knowledge about the world of Islam or the Arab world and the kind of categories we deploy to understand what is going on there and how we understood the Arab or the Islamic world throughout history. So for this reason, I think it is crucial, really, to do what we are doing right now, to look at the Arab revolutions, the Islamic world, and to reflect upon it, to try and produce some kind of knowledge. But I would also like us to try and thematize our own activity, our thinking about the Arab world and the kind of events that we think about, the categories we deploy. Why are we surprised at all? Why are we trying to interpret these events? What's key here is that knowledge about the Islam world, the Islamic or the Arab world produced by the Western world has never been politically indifferent. It's always been produced. It's been historically produced in the context of the relation of the dominance of the so-called Western world and the Oriental world. Or, without going back so much in time, historically, the key issue here is the history of colonialism and then the post-colonial period and the relationship between the West and the so-called third world countries. And now the very specific situation we have. As the readers of Edward Said, we realize that the categories used to describe the Islamic or Arab world have always been part of the game
where what was at stake was the creation of a Western identity. The Islamic or the Oriental world was a mirror for Europe to look at or in while trying to construct its own image. So when we are thinking or talking about the Islamic world, we are talking about ourselves. And I think that is very, very important in that there's a set of categories which have defined the Islamic world for us, and now they have simply disintegrated in the context of the Arab Spring. I think we have to be very distrustful of those categories and try and be very sensitive about the historical context in which those terms were devised. The very opposition in the title of this meeting, the Western world and the Oriental world, religiosity of Islam versus modernity in the West. Such modernizing oppositions which make democracy opposed to Islam or the Islamic tradition, where the West is strongly juxtaposed to Orient, the world of the Orient. So I think we think that some political forms, some Western political formula are the opposite, the very opposite to what can be found in the Oriental Arab Islamic world. In the context of the Arab revolutions, many of these oppositions and categories have collapsed. When I look at literature that analyzes the Arab revolutions, one of the authors who have come up with a new concept for interpretation is Hamid Dabashi, an Iranian-American writer and academic. He says that the Arab revolutions are the end of colonialism, the symbolic geopolitical order of the world, the post-colonial order of the world has collapsed. It wasn't really a colonial order. It ruled after the end of colonialism, but it was still structured by colonial categories, opposing the Western world to the Oriental world. What he says is that this post-colonial period was characterized by the predominance of three meta-narrations, emancipatory narrations which dominated the Islamic or Arab world. So many different anti-colonial nationalisms, socialist projects, and Islamism, political Islam. So for him, the Arab Spring is the point where the narrations which we could understand that had a base in some kind of political action now collapsed. The Arab Spring cannot be explained away with any of these narrations or narratives. So that's where the old categories disappear. We need new ones. And this is why we are surprised. This is why we do not have metaphors to use. We are trying to assimilate those events within the structures of knowledge we know, but that doesn't work. Really? Maybe this interpretation is good at the very offset of the revolution, but in Tunisia right now, the most secular part of society, European values are being changed. The same happens in Egypt. The early projections are coming true. Islamists taking over. What's happened? Well, we see these consequences of the process. So, in a way, this confirms the narratives or stereotypes. So maybe they were not groundless after all. Well, we have entered a completely new phase in those political narratives, however. Again, no revolution is an event. It's always a process. So the revolutions started 2 years ago. They are still ongoing. We are at a certain stage of this process. So it's really difficult to try and offer a very consistent interpretation. And then there's another question about the role of religion and the function of religion after the collapse of the modernizing narratives. The case of Egypt, well, that's a country that has gone through modernization partly referring to or based on socialist ideals, and many other countries of the region have a similar history. So there's more going on, more than that. What he says is that there's no resistance. It's not a struggle between the Western oppressor and the colonized society or country. So instead, he offers a category of deferred resistance. He says that the Arab Spring is the final phase of the colonial struggle. But this time around, Arab societies have revolted against their own structures of power. So they are not being anti-colonial. They are just completing the process of anti-colonial struggle. Because when independence was achieved, they set up some regimes which turned out to be totally authoritarian and violated their rights. Now they are completing that process. What he says is important, I think, because he puts the Arab Revolution within a deeper historical context and shows integral relations between what is going on now and colonial history. It's not just a single event. It's a process, completion of a long historical process of anti-colonialism. They are not fighting the Western colonialists as they did 50 years ago. They are just completing the process of emancipation through different categories. So for him, this post-colonial situation makes for different narratives. According to Debashi, and I think that is important, the category of the West makes no more sense, just as the category of the world of Islam. We need a different map of cultural divisions, another political geography. For him, the Arab Revolution, which is not anti-Western in its basic direction or thrust, it does away with this division between the West and the Islamic world. Right, Professor, the category of the West, is it no longer relevant as a point of reference for the world of Islam? Is it starting to use its own autonomous concepts and projects? And in Egypt, the Muslim Brotherhood had to rise to power. It was very active. It didn't stir the revolution. It was on the verge of it, perhaps. But at the very end, at the climax of the struggle, the Muslim Brotherhood stepped in. But the main thrust came from a different power. Yes. Let me go back to what the doctor has said, the issue of completing the colonial process. Indeed, all the republics were nothing but a product, a state based on the European models. Most of those countries were founded by splitting one single nation, the Arab nation. They speak the same language, they have the same tradition, the same literature, the same religion in most cases, and yet they have been split into different structures which have adopted and accepted this tradition. There's no going back now, but the Syrian, Lebanese or Iranian nations were created in the 1920s, so they are quite new. Another point, going away from the opposition between the Western world and the Islamic world. Well, it may not be quite the case, because now I think everyone is getting concerned with the rise of Islamic fundamentalism. As you said, the Muslim Brotherhood is not just Egypt. It's the same in Tunisia. Hanouchi's party is nothing but Muslim Brotherhood. Then Hamas, which was founded in Israel, is originally an organization of the Muslim Brotherhood. Al-Qaeda, the very radical formation, is ideologically led by Zahiri, the who originates from the Muslim Brotherhood. He's one of the Muslim Brothers who has spread the extremist ideology. In Mali, there's the Al-Qaeda of the Maghreb as well. So there are organizations which have been active in Algeria and still are. They started in the early 1980s. So there is this danger, the danger that Islamization, something everyone is so concerned about, may continue. But I also have another perspective to offer. Islamization fits into a certain broader trend that is observed around the world, the emergence of constitutional theocracies. Really, this is a very interesting phenomenon. We see emerging countries which, unlike in the Islamic period, where the ruler was a theocratic ruler, the caliph was both the monarch and the leader, and then these functions were split. In the Saudi Arabia, there's the ruling family on the one hand, but also the Wahhabi establishment on the other hand. They are the religious side to it. Likewise, in many European countries, especially in Eastern Europe, where religious sentiments of this kind of constitutional or parliamentary theocracy are rising. In Russia, in Poland, we've had this movement emerging after the transition, where the church started to play a very important role together with religion. And, of course, the authorities were non-church related, or they were layman's or authorities. But these developments are taking place. There is increasing religiosity, not only because of the Muslims, although they played a key role in protests against the ban on headscarves, but I can see this development emerge across the board, and I wouldn't be concerned with it. People are going back to religion because most of societies cannot operate without religion. Religion is a very important part of culture, civilization, tradition, and language. Muslim theology or religiosity was key to preserving literary Arabic, whereas every town or village has its own dialect. And Arabs often cannot understand one another when they speak dialect. So religion is an institution which keeps up tradition and helps survive in the Arab world. And I believe that even if the Muslim Brotherhood was not directly engaged in Egypt before, they had a lot of practical experience because they opposed Abd al-Nasser in the 1960s and 70s, and later they were allowed to participate in government by Sadat, then they were kept in check by Mubarak. But it's the same with Hamas and Anad's party in Tunisia. So it's similar everywhere, but in Algeria, because Algeria has the trauma of civil war behind it. And then, going back to the Western world, the West still exists, and we really wreaked havoc in the Islamic world before. Is there an Islamic country which has been really consistent in its creation of a lay state? Turkey, right? The struggle of emancipation and trying to reconcile traditional concepts and individualism, also people's control of their own fate, bodies, and so on. So how much is Turkey a point of reference for the Islamic world, or is the Islamic world really a point of reference for Turkey? Well, Turkey is not a point of reference for the other countries, Islamic countries, because of this prevalent laicity, which was not accepted for Turks by Turks for a long time. And in Turkey, to this day, there is still consequences of the forced secularity. I have Turkish students. When I talk to them, it's really hard to talk about Kemalism and the past, because they were taught in schools to say that that's the only way, that's the good way, that's the right way. This is their communism that they had to swallow, and young people still do that. But we know that Turkey has changed. The party of progress and development is a purely Islamic party. It has Islamic roots. There's a very clear return to Islamic schools. And in the country, the Muslim tradition has never been abandoned. Even polygamy was practiced illicitly, secretly, but still it was practiced even in Turkey. Despite 90 years of statehood, as Ibn Khaldun, a great Arab historian, said, dynasties should last no longer than five generations. So that's how much the Turkish state has survived. So nothing is obvious about it, and it cannot really be encapsulated in clear categories. We may suspect or try to interpret the situation. And then when we talk about the position of women, and I'd like to talk about the performance we witnessed, but maybe later on that. Yes, this is something we will discuss. Monika, you researched these themes. So classical emancipation known from our modernity, feminism as a new front, expanding the freedoms. To what extent is that something present in the countries you've been working in? How much are these strategies borrowed from the West? How much are they grassroots strategies? Because feminism, there's this term of Islamic feminism. Could you explain about it? Sure, but before I do that, let me just comment very briefly about religion and the division between the Islamic world and the Western world, in inverted commas. I sympathize with Dabashi. I'm very skeptical about this division. You said quite correctly, Professor, that this development of religiosity is not happening only in the Islamic world. It happens in other regions of the world as well. Modernity, more education, technological progress, democracy are combined with secularity, but not always and not everywhere. That's an old dogma of modernization. We think that religion and modernity or progress are the opposites. But that's not true, empirically speaking. And that's something we have to bear in mind when we look at the Arab world, because then we are surprised. They are religious. How can they be democratic? That surprise is based on these modernizing categories. But I'd like to go back to the reason for the strength of Islamic religious discourses in the Islamic world. That's not the only reason. It is perhaps overdetermined, but it is true that at the time of the Cold War, supporting religious movements and organizations was a strategy of the West to counter the impact of the communist bloc. So there is this history of Western societies that supported, financed many religious organizations as a counterweight to the ideology of communism. After the end of the Cold War, this gave rise to the Taliban, who have been financed by the West during the war in Afghanistan, but in other countries as well. What we see is that there is no alternative emancipatory narrative, especially after the collapse of the communist bloc, where communism is no longer an option. In the context of neoliberal economics, those who are at the bottom of social structure have no narrative, no organizational structure to give them hope. And in many Arab countries, and that's the case of the Muslim Brotherhood, they first worked by supporting the poor, doing charity work. And that's true of many countries. Not only the Muslim Brotherhood, but also other religious organizations have charity purposes. That's my experience in Morocco. My friends in Morocco showed me city neighborhoods administered by Islamists as opposed to other neighborhoods where they were absent, because they have something to offer to the poor. They can support playgrounds for kids. They offer assistance to women. They offer charity projects. So in this reality, the real strength of the discourses of religious organizations derives from the economic reality and the absence of any other emancipatory narratives at this time. I think this is the aspect to consider as well. And as it is, historically speaking, the Western drive to eradicate the enemy, that is the communist ideology, is the reason why this is the only discourse available to many groups in society. Plus, there is the class aspect, and that's also quite clear in Egypt. These very nasty, radical religious groups, very conservative ones, well, there are very strong class divisions well, we go back to the roots. This is what they say. They are fundamentalists. In many cases, this is what the people want. On the other hand, there is the radical youth, those people, young people in the Tahrir square. So it's not really a representation of the entire nation. The nation have spoken. They want others in power. But this may change any minute now, and then we know what could happen. It might well be that the more traditional, well, if not theologians, then at least people in power, they will lose power because society will emancipate. But this is not happening now because people are not educated. Most people are not educated, not to speak about Afghanistan, where the rate of literacy is 30% among men. In Egypt, it's about 60. The others are illiterate. So clearly, this is a very difficult situation. And for those people, as you said, this is the only option, the only system that can organize something around them. Right, let's go back to and think about how these aspirations can be achieved. They are not sealed off from the world. They know about other cultures, not only the West. India, for instance, there is emancipation there too. Over the past dozens of years, they have parity quotas in politics. They allocate a certain proportion of seats in parliament to women. In China, with all the political specificity of the country, women have gained a lot of rights, and all of this seeps through. They are not sealed off. So what about the role of women? Women are now much better educated than they were the revolution in Iran, 1979, as compared to today. These are two different worlds in terms of education of women. Same is true of Tunisia. So how does this translate into the processes we've discussed? How much are women a factor, a driving force? That's interesting. It's interesting to look at the contribution of women to the Arab Spring. For instance, in Egypt, on the one hand, there was a big contribution indeed. Women played a very important role. And there is a myth, a real myth of the first 18 days in Tahrir Square, which was the time of a real community of protesters. Women were not exposed to violence at all. But then it came to an abrupt end, and that's quite typical that this mythical community of protesters where women became for the first time involved in political activity on a large scale in big numbers. In March 2011, soon after the revolution broke out, 200, maybe 300 women organized a demonstration of women asking for more rights, and they were ridiculed, mocked by men. There were also cases of violence and harassment. So this myth of solidarity crossing all divides of gender collapsed. And later on, women were exposed to violence from the state, which is typical. Protesters are crushed by the police or the military, who use physical violence, including testing women for virginity. Women who were detained were tested whether they were virgins or not in the presence of male soldiers. And then a well-known video, which was notorious in the media across the world, showing a woman in a blue bra. She was beaten by soldiers, then there was another woman in a red cape. That was very frustrating, and it showed that the participation of women in the Arab Spring did not really mean that they were automatically considered to be political subjects who could claim their own rights. This is the reality of the Arab Revolution. In Egypt, it was different in Tunisia and other countries, but as for feminist issues, women's rights, this is a very complex story because the Arab countries are very different from one another historically. In those countries that had a stage of socialist modernization, the political status of women is different. It was different until 2004 in Morocco than it was in Tunisia. It was different in Egypt. So it would be nonsensical to say that women in the Arab world are this or that. There's nothing like the Arab world as a whole. And that's very clear when you look at the different story of legislating women's rights. Women are in a different cultural and political situation in different countries. As for the history of the struggle for women's rights, this is what you asked about, whether this is a kind of influence from the West. Well, historians, women historians who research Egypt say, Margaret Badran, for instance, she finds signals of proto-feminism in the 19th century. She's very insistent on this being an endogenous, local, grassroots struggle for rights. Nothing like imitation of Western ideals. In many contexts, women became engaged in nationalist struggle for independence. They were part of the national movement, and in most cases, they were later betrayed by that movement, clearly in Egypt. The first time that women took part in street demonstrations was in the 1919-1920, when Egypt started to try and shed off the yoke of colonialism. But then it turned out that not all nationalist parties were interested in women's rights, so it took much more, this whole struggle. But it started really early on in different Arab countries, and it went through different stages. In Algeria, for instance, women took part in the struggle for independence, and this really changed the thinking about the relations between the two sexes, which is not to say that women were given equal rights, because after the struggle for independence, women were perhaps believed to be heroines, but not entitled to equal rights. There were different conferences, feminist conferences, feminist magazines in the 1930s, 40s, and 50s in the Arab world. These feminist movements were quite often, well, they were never opposed to religion. They were secular, but they could reconcile their political project with religion. Some of those women toyed with socialist or communist ideology. So there's a whole history of feminist movements in the Arab world. Egypt is a special case, but that's one part of the story. What I'm interested in, and what seems to be quite fascinating, is not the Muslim feminism, Islamic feminism, which has a long history. It was secular, but it was somehow tied to religion. In addition to that, there is the Islam feminism or Islamic feminism. One of the authors key to this, Zibamir Hosseini, who's Iranian, an anthropologist of law, she calls Islamic feminism the unwanted child of political feminism. And you talked about the relations with the West and with the local emancipatory projects. Well, Islamic feminism is different. It tries to claim women's rights by grounding them not in human rights discourse or other enlightenment narratives, but in Quran. Quran, religion, Islam should be the source of women's rights. And that's a completely different approach than the earlier Muslim feminism would propose. Well, Islamic feminists are not saying that they are not challenging the fact that Islamic societies are very misogynist, that the interpretation of history is also misogynist. This is something they are not challenging, but they're also saying that in its gist, the Quran, Islam are egalitarian, and that religion could be reinterpreted to ground the equality of the sexes in it. We just need to unpack the historically conditioned patriarchal interpretations of religion. Why is this project so interesting, politically speaking? Because it's a product of this very strange political conundrum of the women in the Arab world. On the one hand, they don't want to be bedfellows with Western feminism because they know that Western feminism went hand in hand with colonialism and imperialism in the West. Feminist narratives were taken advantage of by the Western powers to legitimize the interventions in Iraq or Afghanistan. After all, we came to Afghanistan to liberate women. So the discourse was used by the US administration to that effect quite a lot. So women, these women say, no, we don't want you, Western feminists. You were colonizers yourselves, and at least some of you are very good friends with colonial politicians. So they do not want to have this very close relationship with Western feminism. So they want their own subjectivity. On the other hand, they identify with Islam, but most of Islam is patriarchal and misogynist. So they say no to their own tradition. They want to find something that would favor women and be grounded in this tradition. She says that Islamic feminism is an unwanted child of political Islamism, and that's because political Islamism is a modern movement. It says societies have been spoiled. They have to be reborn by going back to the roots of Islam. So political Islamism goes back to religious roots in order to reorganize society. When this started, feminists decided that we could go back to the origins of Islam and see whether they are really as patriarchal as they are claimed to be. So she says that Islamic feminists were inspired by political Islamists, and they said, okay, if we want to reinterpret society from the perspective of Islamic rules, let's look at those Islamic roots and see whether they are really patriarchal and misogynist. And they said they are not. So it's like an intellectual game. They are well-educated women. Many of them are academics. So they do a lot of hermeneutic work with the Quran, and they show that the patriarchal interpretations are historically conditioned, that the Quran could be reinterpreted, the Shariat could be reinterpreted. That's a lot of academic abstract work, but a flagship example of the success of this political project, which roots feminism in religious origins, is the reform of family law in Morocco. Until 2004, it was very bad for women, family law. It was traditionalist, it introduced a certain hierarchy in marriage, and in 2004, by initiative of the king, they introduced a new code, which is very progressive in its egalitarian approach. Women and men are equal in families. It regulates inheritance and taking care of children. So that's very important, because the reference point here was Fatima Mernissi, one of the key figures in Islamic feminism. Her books in the 1980s were banned. And in the 2000s, she was invited to meet with the king, and then the king promoted her traditional Islamic arguments. They would not have reformed the law in such an egalitarian spirit in Morocco if they had not had those very local Islamic origins to work on. But since Islamic feminisms had developed religious arguments in favor of egalitarianism, they were taken advantage of, and the law is very progressive. That was interesting. The king, when he spoke and explained this whole reform project, he talked about Fatima Mernissi. 20 years earlier, she was a black sheep. Before I open the floor, let me go back to you, Professor. How much do you think that such projects, intellectual experiments, could be an inspiration for innovations and a new vision of the political and social community, combining tradition, which is inevitable, as we know, but maybe tradition can be modernized? Well, this is a cycle. In Tunisia, in 1957, they had the most modern law with full equality of women and men, unlike in traditional Islam, unlike in Morocco to this date. There was no difference with regard to divorce. A man can always get a divorce. A woman, well, faces some difficulty. But in Tunisia, they had equal rights. Go to court, get a divorce. There was no difference between men and women. Now, there is no new constitution yet, but there are serious debates about the equality of women. And the same is true of Egypt. It started with the issue of electing women judges, because the constitution says, it's said that a judge can be an Egyptian man. It says an Egyptian Muslim man. So a woman cannot be a judge, it was deemed, because that's what the constitution says. After a long debate, the constitutional court said it was an Egyptian citizen, a Muslim citizen, not an Egyptian man or a woman. So a woman could be a judge because she is a citizen. So modernity is not going to emerge abruptly. In Morocco, after all, the king's decree stirred some reactions of the fundamentalist, traditionalist people who said, no, we'll go on protest. There were rebellions against this new code of law, family code, I think. So that's what happened. I wanted to go back to the performance we saw. What I've seen in the Arab world is the opposite process. A scantily dressed woman, once there was a fashion for women, it was in fashion for women to wear shorts. But in Baghdad, the chief of the police forced women to paint their legs because they shouldn't be wearing shorts. And then in the socialist or a bus, Baghdad, well, the tradition was present. But in Cairo, I saw something I didn't ever see in Poland. Here in Poland, in Warsaw, I was a student and I was staying at a dormitory. In order to enter the dormitory for women, I had to submit my student's ID and leave within 2 hours, or I would never be allowed to come back again. In Cairo, my friend lived in the women's dormitory. I was staying at a hostel, but when I wanted to visit her, I could at any time, and nobody wanted me to submit my ID. Although everyone knew that I was visiting, of course, it was difficult not to notice. But it was a different attitude. Together with my colleagues, other female students, I could easily go on a bus anywhere in Cairo or Egypt. And then in the late 1970s, with al-Sadat, it started to change. The Muslim Brotherhood grew stronger, and women started wearing headscarves. But that was also a way to rebel against the West. This was the time of the big trauma after 1967, then 1973, and the victory of the Iranian Revolution. So this really boosted the Islamic pride. It grew, and it caused a return to Islam. Now women are doing the opposite, not only in Morocco, but also in Saudi Arabia. Things that are unheard of. Women are deputy ministers for now, but they will be elected to parliament. Well, the parliament has very restricted powers, but it's not what you might think, that it's very undemocratic. Of course, the king elects and dismisses members of parliament as he likes, but I have taken part in a meeting of the Saudi parliament on several occasions, and they had a very good quality debate on serious issues, matters of the state. And the laws that were adopted would be signed by the king being Abdallah. That was the beginning of his reign, but it was clear that the reforms were starting. How this will go from now on, we don't know. He's quite old at this time, and who takes over is an open question. It's very complex in Saudi Arabia. But I don't think there's any abrupt change taking place, and that's a good thing, that there are no abrupt changes. If you wanted to visit a women's dormitory, well, you could do that in Poland, but it's been 30 or 40 years, so nothing happens overnight. Plus, there are political problems on top of that. the changes that have started, I mean. So it may take more time. And as you've said, it's different in every Arab country. You cannot put them on a par and say it's the same everywhere. But in addition to that, this is not a linear process. What is key for me is that now there's another generation of women in the Arab countries who are educated. Statistically speaking, they are very well educated compared to the generation of their mothers. Yes, in Iran, there are more women students than men students. Yes, but what is quite broadly commented upon is this return to religion on the part of women who are well educated. For instance, in Egypt, Saba Mahmoud is writing about that. She says it's a pious movement. And there are many cases, like in Turkey, for instance, the veiling movement, where women, young, educated women, claim the right to wear headscarves, whereas their mothers never did. So there is no pressure of tradition. It's their idea, their identity, their religiosity, their public personas. And of course, there are many interpretations of this development. For instance, how Turkish modernization reached out to different social classes to a different extent. And then there's another theory that says that women who want to veil their heads or faces, and that's an act of political resistance. Turkey does not allow women to wear headscarves in universities. So for women, it's an important element of the identity. Their experience in this modernized country, well, they have been exposed to the contradictions of modernity, the expectations for women. They have to be present in the public. They have to be workers. They have to build the nation. But they must also be mothers and women. So these expectations are ridden with contradictions. The emphasis on religion is a way to escape these contradictions. It's a way to reclaim those traditional women's values. There's a similar interpretation of another phenomenon, a rising phenomenon in Europe, the number of conversions of European women to Islam. This sounds very surprising. How can this be taking place? But it is also interpreted in the feminist spirit. Women who are under pressure of this individualist turbo-capitalism, expecting them to be individuals, coping in the labor market, in their own lives, building up their careers while they are being in a very precarious situation. And they should also be women and mothers and so on. And there are such structural contradictions involved that their opting for religion is a way out of these contradictions. It's a utopian return to the traditional gender roles involving respect for traditional femininity. So this phenomenon is interpreted along feminist lines. And you might think how much religion becomes, again, a space of emancipation. It's very difficult to even think about it. And feminist theory has a big problem with how to think about women becoming real subjects in the area of religion. But these developments are taking place also in the Muslim world. And then it's not a linear process. If you look at 20th century history of the Arab countries and the situation of women in some of these countries, they had it better before. If you look at Egypt, for instance, the 1960s constitution, 71, well, the constitution from the time of socialist experiments in its spirit, setting aside social practice and the overall situation of women's organizations, the constitution was egalitarian. It said we have to throw away the shackles binding women's hands, and the 1970s constitution in Egypt made took a step back. It tried to reintroduce the idea of complementarity of women and men. It mentions women's right to participate in public life, provided, however, that it doesn't conflict with their family life. So it is not a linear process. It's not that things progress only. Well, I think it's quite clear that it's never that simple, either there or closer to home. Well, may I now open the floor for your comments and questions? Arkadiusz Durszak, you have presented, especially the doctor presented an approach derived from Edward Said. You say that in our interpretations of Islam, we are tainted by a colonialist approach. When you say we, who do you mean exactly? Because you present the approach of a Western European. I am an Eastern or Central European, as most people in this room, I believe, and the experience of Eastern and Central Europeans are very different, speaking of contacts with Islam. We do not have a colonialist past. We were attacked. This part of Europe was attacked by Islam, and you skipped this altogether, both of you. You say, we, the West, have wreaked havoc. I'm not the West. I do not identify with this completely. This is a topic you've skipped. There are millions of people without the colonialist experience. And one more thing, what you didn't mention either was the movement in the Islamic world, especially in Iran, that is feminism or a kind of democracy, liberation, by rejecting Islam and finding freedom in another religion like Christianity in Iran or Zoroastrianism, or just rejection of religion altogether through atheism or agnosticism. And that's a very strong movement, especially among Iranian immigrants. And that's a very strong movement you failed to mention in the Arab world, also thanks to the internet revolution. Arab atheists are now starting to speak up. They reject Islam quite vocally, and I think, I hope this movement will rise. Thank you very much. Well, that's the beauty of a discussion. Something that hasn't been mentioned so far can be brought up later. Monika, well, I have prepared more comments to present, also about the spatial location in this colonial drama. I just didn't want to take up too much of your time. That is a very interesting question for a host of different reasons. Discussions about colonialism, which are part of post-colonial theory, completely leave aside the second world, the world that we were part of. And that's a very interesting conceptual omission. Well, one problem here is that when we think about the outside world, that's part of our being part of the Western culture, reading Western books and looking at the Arab world from the perspective of Western literature. And there's a big debate around the question of how much are we part of the West? We, Eastern Europe, the Second World, as it was known before. That's very interesting. If you think about it, I think this will take you to what I mentioned before, the collapse of the category of the West. The category West makes no sense after the end of the Cold War, after the post-communist world joined the West. Does the concept West make any sense from the analytical perspective? Is it consistent? The relationship between the Second World and the Arab world is very interesting because of the structure of the Cold War relations. This is what you mentioned before, Professor. Many Arab countries trying to flirt with socialism called themselves democratic republics. Algeria still is called a democratic republic. And that's part of our history, the relations between the Second World and the Third World. This history hasn't really been described in sufficient detail. You know, the whole heritage of this relationship, how much of that has survived, and what does it mean? So you're absolutely right. In the beginning, I wanted to emphasize how important it is to be sensitive to the historical and political context of the production of knowledge and the origin of the categories we use to describe others, the other, the non-European. Here, we must also bear in mind our own epistemological position in order to problematize our own relationship with the West in the beginning, and also our Polish relationship to Islam. For instance, the Islamophobia, which is prevalent in Poland, and this is a kind of Islamophobia without Muslims. Here we are taking over some Western European discourses, you know, Islamophobia is one of them, and for me this is a form of inclusion, an attempt to be 100% European. So somehow, through our Islamophobic approach to Islam, we are trying to prove how European we are. So I think this is also part of the game. But that's a very important point you've raised. Professor, how about these anti-Islamic movements where people reject Islam, go for another religion? There is no research available. We don't know how widespread it is for people to reject Islam, to become atheists in the Muslim world. But from my experience, from my contacts over a long period of time and quite recently, I believe that this is still a very small phenomenon. Sometimes when I dare say I'm an atheist, people look at me there and say, that is not possible in the world. There are no people who don't believe in a God. So it is still unimaginable. And I think maybe that's part of the revolt of the young. People who are perhaps still under the influence of us, Europeans, the European tradition. For them, this kind of Muslim fundamentalist perspective on the world is unacceptable. But that's more of a revolt than premeditated atheism, I think. But again, there is no research I know of. And just one more comment about colonialism. Unfortunately, as a Pole, I don't feel fully comfortable because the 2000s is when I was very critical about Poland for what we did first in Iraq and then in Afghanistan. This was not good. I think it really distorted the vision of Poland in that world. People are now looking at us differently, and not the same way that they look at British people or the French, not to speak about Americans, but certainly not in the same way they used to. Any further questions or comments? artist wants to take part in this debate. I wanted to talk about the situation in Turkey from the Turkish perspective. The doctor talked about feminism. However, I'd like to talk about feminist activism in Turkey. The situation in Turkey as compared to other Arab countries is obviously different. However, similar to other Muslim countries, there is now in Turkey a movement of people reverting to conservatism over the past years. In addition, however, there are also very active women's movements. So, for instance, there is a lot of activism concerning the wearing of headscarves by women. Although it is an Islamist party, a conservative party that is in power, women who wore scarves couldn't work in government institutions. And this situation started in Turkey with the onset of the Republic. Women would wear Western European clothes, but they would still be in playing the traditional role in the family by the husband's side. Whether or not women wore headscarves, they worked together in the feminist movement. So, whether a woman would wear a headscarf or not played a minor role. All women, both closer to the military republican affiliation or the more conservative tradition, started to use their own bodies in order to express their opinions. And in this way, whether women wore scarves or not, they started to claim their own rights and support one another.
Wszystkie zdawaliśmy sobie sprawę z tego, że mamy wspólne problemy.
We realized that we had similar problems, whoever we were. So women wearing no headscarves started to support and assist the more traditional women and the other way around. A woman wearing a headscarf is not a woman without identity. It is not a helpless woman, and the same is true of a woman who wears no headscarf. Our major problem, however, is that we are being taken advantage of as a political tool. We shouldn't be considered to be a threat, a Western threat for the East or an Eastern threat to the West. Thank you for your attention. Thank you for these comments. Are there any further comments in this discussion?
Ja może będę za dużo chciała, nie mają państwo szklanej kuli, nie mogę.
Well, obviously you do not have a crystal ball and you cannot anticipate the future, but you're the experts. Over the past 2 years, the dust has settled. The dust that could have revealed something fantastic, and instead it has revealed something very worrying. Dictatorships have been toppled, sure, but at the same time, it was the end of the failure of the project to replace old structures with modern states, providing their people with whatever was needed to satisfy their needs. There are major concerns whether any religious movements, with any social charity work they do, are more predestined to build countries that could satisfy the basic fundamental needs of people in Egypt or Tunisia or other countries. So what do you think? What are your expectations and your concerns? That's a big question. We are going back to the main theme again, so thank you for your question. Let me think. So first, I'd like to go back to what we've been discussing. It's not a linear, progressive process. It goes up and down. That's how it works. Now that it's mainly Muslim organizations, with a strong attachment to religion, are taking over, doesn't mean that they do not want democracy. And socialism and equality, that's really a big part of the new Egyptian constitution. In the 1950s, Estirakiyat al-Islam, that is the socialism of Islam, that's a book that was published by a member of the Muslim Brotherhood, he was trying to prove the point being that everything has already happened in Islam, including social insurance, not in the late 19th century, but in the 7th century. He said, we created a just society based on what is known as shura, that is advising the ruler, the monarch, today the upper house of the parliament in Egypt and in Tunisia, and in Saudi Arabia, it's also called shura. So, unfortunately, I am of the opinion that these countries face a serious economic collapse after what's happened. The assistance from Europe and from the West is not enough. It won't help much. What such collapse, economic collapse, could result in, it's difficult to tell. Will there be social revolts? Will people come to terms with it? Looking at the case of Poland, I don't think there'll be a revolt. We accept the economic collapse in Poland. Of course, we keep complaining about Balcerowicz, but we understood that it was necessary. It was a sacrifice. And those societies also understand that. And we'll see how things develop. And of course, the young people are revolting. And then there's another important point that the doctor here has only touched upon. Something that reflects on the approach to women, something that was unknown in Egypt. Rape. Women were respected. They were not harassed in any way. Only European women were pinched or hassled on the bus, but not Egyptian women. This was a no-no. Now, things that would be unheard of are taking place, as I know from my students. So I'm not familiar with details, but I think the situation is not very rosy. There's a certain decline taking place, and this is happening in Egypt, in northern Egypt, Suez, Cairo. There are revolts, and the authorities are not able to cope. Maybe the military, because the military is a big power in Egypt. But this could mean an end to the democratic transition. That's in Egypt. In Tunisia, I think it's evolving slowly. In Yemen, that's another important country in the region. There are two horrible states, Syria, an unsolved problem, and Libya, another unsolved problem. In both cases, it's us who interfered too much. Gaddafi was toppled by the NATO, not the revolted boys driving Toyotas in northern Libya, in Syria. The people were not willing to overthrow the regime. They were used to the status quo. Now, chaos rules, and the chaos could continue for many years, and the situation there is perilous because there will be a reaction of extreme fundamentalism opposing the non-Muslim government, Alevite government. So that's not a very clear prospect for the future. There's very little hope of a calm, rosy future. There's no flicker of hope in the Arab world. We'll see what happens in our world. The crisis has persisted, although it's been said to decline. Monika, anything else from you? Well, irrespective of those difficult times faced by these societies, there's one fundamental issue. This kind of mobilization, the experience of the several days in the beginning, followed by other protests, this forms a generation. That's the end of the lies that I mentioned. There's an experience of empowerment that cannot be crushed. It will not stop. And as for women and their participation in the protests, of course, they were badly affected in other ways, but an important development in Egypt was in December 2011, after the violations, the violence against women, you know, the woman in the blue bra that I mentioned. Several days after, a big demonstration was organized against violence against women. Apparently, 10,000 women took part. Most of them were women. And this is considered one of the biggest women's demonstrations in Egypt since 1919. So that's another kind of capital there. When I talk to my friends in Morocco, well, you have depreciated Morocco, Professor, because it hasn't been on the same scale, but there was a wave of protests, and it led to the referendum where the Moroccans, well, it's deemed to be an artificial or an unlimited or a very limited move, the limitation of the power of the monarch in Morocco. But there are signs of change in Morocco. And from what my friends are telling me, and they are not politicians, they are not directly involved in politics, several people told me that they feel very different in the streets. They look at the police in a different way. The police are no more a big power. A police officer is no more a representative of the evil that threatens them. Something has changed, even in Morocco, on a much smaller scale, thanks to the protests. People feel different faced with the machinery of the state or law enforcement such as the police. So this is evolving, even if it's a very slow evolution. From my contacts with people in the university in Morocco, students are becoming more active. They want to do things. A professor was very proud, showed me a website where students publish their articles. And one important aspect, there's no interference of the government. In his narrative, 2-3 years before, this would not have been possible. So these are small steps that change the everyday experience of people and make them empowered more. Not to, well, to set aside the economic problems they are faced with and the political turbulences, which are inevitable. So there is a flicker of hope. We have two more bidders for the floor, and then we shall wrap up, but we shall continue next door where we can watch a video installation and continue our discussions over a glass of wine. Two more questions. I have a question. Something I haven't been able to get here in Poland, something that you may be familiar with, something that was ignored in the States because the Americans didn't understand it. That's something that a friend of mine told me about. It's about a statement of Bin Laden, why the World Trade Center terrorist attack took place on 9/11, because that's an anniversary of the Battle of Vienna in 1863, the battle that stopped the victorious march of Islam in Europe. That's very important for me. He thinks that Bin Laden, thinks that he continues the Islamic invasion in Europe back from the 16th, 17th century. That's one thing. And now, what happens next to us and to Islam? Let me start with an anecdote. But I'm quite serious about this anecdote, and I will extrapolate it. Well, several years ago, I read in a Polish paper a report from France. For legal reasons, the family of an imam were expelled from France. He was in violation of French law. So his family were expelled, that is, the imam, his two wives, and 16 children. Well, if it goes on like that, and I'm extrapolating now, in 2100, 90% of people in the world will be Muslim, because we cannot keep up with this competition. Now, what does this mean? Well, this is something you said before. There are many rules of Sharia law that we find unacceptable. Holy war, death penalty for conversion from Islam, violence against women, and so on. So how can a compromise be reached? It's impossible. Well, in Egypt, as you said, a judge must be a Muslim. But in 1573, we had adopted the Warsaw Confederation, which granted religious freedom to all citizens. So all religions were deemed to be equal. And Casimir the Great, in the 14th century, granted citizenship rights to Russian Orthodox noblemen. Now, several hundred years later, so let's take the final question and then wrap up. Well, Breivik was also inspired by John the Third Sobieski in his writings. So let's be just, if Vienna, the Battle of Vienna, is an inspiration. Well, it is my impression that you are very Eurocentric when you talk about Islam. You seem to suggest that Islam and Arab countries try to accommodate European culture. But maybe it's the other way around. Maybe our culture, with its very rapid expansion, exploration and exploitation of natural resources and energy, expansion of information, no one can grasp the quantity of intellectual production. And also, we replace our equipment not every 2 or 3 years, but every 2 or 3 months. Now, there is a huge gap between the need for security and peace in society and what we now have developed in Europe. Maybe we are coming to an end, like the Roman Empire when it declined. Maybe they are right. Maybe we should have a stable culture based on faith and co-optation, what the Catholic Church has proposed for years, without haste or excessive progress or exploitation of natural resources. Maybe we should go back to the quiet Middle Ages before the historical changes. Keep it quiet, keep it peaceful, everyone in their own place, inheriting their father's place. Maybe that's the way to go. because otherwise we will decline and they will emerge and rise. Well, that's an interesting question. Let's try and wrap up. Let's begin with Jan the Third Sobieski. I interpreted the first statements of Osama bin Laden on air in the radio. He never said that. Or maybe he did, but I'm not aware of that. Maybe he did, maybe his organization did. There was a big scandal in Poland once. Osama bin Laden wanted to attack Poland and Poles because on Al-Qaeda website they published very detailed information about Poland. We soon discovered this was copied from a text published by the Polish embassy in Cairo, and this is why they had very detailed information about Poland. Maybe it mentioned John the Third Sobieski, although the suggestion that he stopped the Islamic invasion of Europe was put forth by one of the greatest Arabists in the world, Bernard Lewis. That was his idea. In his history of Islam, for the first time, he put forth this idea. Now, is Shariat incompatible with our culture? Of course not. It is not compatible. It's based on a different tradition. Why should we use Shariat law just as the Muslims don't want to accept some parts of the European perspective on the law? Because, for instance, Shariat regulates the time of prayers, ablutions, pilgrimages, not to Jasna Góra in Poland, but to Mecca. This is what they need and want, just as our law provides for things that we need or want. These things may be different, but the spirit of the law is similar. Even if, as you said, there is a death penalty, well, Muslim law does not mention rejection of God, but divorce, for instance, can be punished with death penalty. But death penalty was eliminated in Poland, what, 20, 30 years ago? It is still used in many states of the U.S. So there are cultural differences, yes. But you have also reminded me when you said that Islam will overwhelm us. I've once talked to Russian or Soviet politicians. They said, we have a problem with the Muslim republics. There are 50 million of them. There's 120 million of us, Russians. So in 30 years' time, there'll be many more of them than us. And the Communist Party of the USSR will be a Muslim party. Well, nothing came out of it. So as you can see, history took a different turn. Can Islam be an alternative? Well, it is not an alternative for me. And as it often happens in history of humankind, the next stage in the history of civilization is a synthesis. We know what happened to Alexander the Great. After the Greek tradition, what happened was Hellenism. It was not a Greek tradition. It was a Middle Eastern, Indian, Egyptian, Greek tradition. This was a synthesis. And now we have a European globalism, which is also a synthesis of different civilizations, not to mention the Chinese tradition, something we should always bear in mind. Thank you. Monika? Well, all those concerns disappear when you start to look at things more closely in the Muslim world. Suddenly, you find out These are just preconceptions. We take over from the colloquial thinking about Islam. When you look at societies, the diversity of their experience of religion, the internal diversity of Islam, the complexity of those societies in terms of class, culture, language, when you think of these very simple observations, the Arab societies are a small fraction of the Islam, of the Muslim population around the world. Indonesia is the biggest Islamic state. There are many different Islamic countries, more than 50, who are mutually conflicted politically. So when you look at it closely, there's no such thing as Islam. There are many different Islams and thousands or millions of ways to experience religion. On top of that, there is social class, gender, language, political complexities of individuals and groups. So the picture becomes so complex that none of those concerns you've voiced seem to make sense. That's my response. We just need to know more about this complex reality, and then our fears disappear. Thank you so much. Thank you for this wrap-up. Thank you for all your statements, comments, questions. Let's continue this event next door. Life continues. Please proceed to watch the video installations and continue our discussion over wine, so not fully in line with the Muslim tradition, but please join us there. Thank you so much. Thank you for the translation. We've had interpretation into English, so everyone could listen in. Thank you again.